Philosopher's Stone. Let's go. I know you have it, said Professor McGonagall, sounding half exasperated and half admiring, but you're different. Everyone knows you're the only one you know. Oh, all right, Voldemort was frightened of him. You flatter me, said Dumbledore calmly. Professor McGonagall shot a sharp look at Dumbledore and said, "The owls are nothing next to the rumors that are flying around. You know what they're saying about why he's disappeared, but what finally stopped him?" It seemed that Professor McGonagall had reached a point she was most anxious to discuss. The real reason she had been waiting on a cold, hard wall all day. As a woman that she fixed Dumbledore with such piercing stare as she did now, it was plain that whatever everyone was saying, she was not going to believe it until Dumbledore told her it was true. Dumbledore, however, was choosing another lemon drop and did not answer. "What they're saying," she pressed on, "is that last night Voldemort turned up in Godric's Hollow. Somehow broke, and that's why he's gone. Dumbledore nodded glumly. It's true," faltered Professor McGonagall. "After all he's done, all the people he's killed, he couldn't kill a little boy. It's just astounding. All the things to stop him, but now in the name of heaven did Harry survive? We can only guess," said Dumbledore. "We may never know." Professor McGonagall pulled out a lace handkerchief and dabbed at her eyes beneath her spectacles. Dumbledore gave a great sniff as he took a golden watch from his pocket and examined it. It was a very odd watch. It had 12 hands but no numbers. Instead, little planets were moving around the edge. It must have made sense to Dumbledore, though, because he put it back in his pocket and said, "Hagrid's late. I suppose it was he who told you I'd be here, by the way." "Yes," said Professor McGonagall, "and I won't. And I don't suppose you're going to tell me why you're here of all places." "I've come to bring Harry to his aunt and uncle. They're the only family he has left now." "Professor McGonagall not something you will even remember. Can you see how much better off you'll be growing up away from all that until you're ready to take it? Professor McGonagall opened her mouth, changed her mind, swallowed, and then said, "Yes, yes, you're right. Of course. But how is the boy getting here, Dumbledore?" She eyed his cloak suddenly, as though she thought he might be hiding Harry underneath it. Hagrid's bringing him. You think it wise to trust Hagrid with something as important as this? I will trust Hagrid with my life, said Dumbledore. I'm just saying his heart is in the right place, said Professor McGonagall grudgingly. But you can't pretend he's not careless. He does tend to. What was that? A low rumbling sound had broken the silence around him. It was steadily louder as they looked up and down the street for some sign of a headlight. It swelled to a roar as they both looked up at the sky. And a huge motorcycle fell out of the air and landed on a road in front of them. And the motorcycle was huge. It was nothing to the man sitting astride it. He was almost twice as tall as the normal man and at least five times as wide. He looked simply too big to be allowed and so wild. Long tangles of bushy black hair and beard hid most of his face. He had the hands the size of trash can lids and his feet and their leather boots were like baby dolphins. In his fast muscular arms he was holding a bundle of blankets. Hagrid said Dumbledore, sounding relieved. At last, and where did you get that motorcycle? Borrowed it, Professor Dumbledore, sir, said the giant, climbing carefully off the motorcycle as he spoke. Young Sirius Black lent it to me. I've gotten him, sir. No problems were there. No, sir. House was almost destroyed, but I got him out all right before the muggles started swarming around. He fell asleep as he was flying over Bristol. Dumbledore and Professor McGonagall bent forward over the bundle of blankets. Inside, just visible was a baby boy fast asleep under a tuft of jet black hair. Over his forehead, they could see a curiously shaped cut, like a bolt of lightning. Is that where? Whispered Professor McGonagall. Yes, said Dumbledore. You'll have that scar forever. Couldn't you do something about it, Dumbledore? Even if I could, I wouldn't. Scars can come in handy. I have one myself above my left knee that is a perfect map of the London Underground. Well, give him here, Hagrid. We better get this over with. Dumbledore took Harry in his arms and turned toward the Dursley's house. Could I say goodbye to him, sir? Asked Hagrid. He bent his great shaggy head over Harry and gave him what must have been a very scratchy, whiskery kiss. Then suddenly Hagrid let out a howl like a wounded dog. Shh! It's Professor McGonagall. You'll wake the muggles. Sorry, sobbed Hagrid, taking out a large spotted handkerchief and burying his face in it. But I can't stand it. Lily and James dead, and poor little Harry off to live with the muggles. Yes, it's all very sad, but get a grip on yourself. Hagrid won't be found, Professor McGonagall whispered, patting Hagrid gingerly on the arm as Dumbledore stepped over the large garden wall and walked to the front door. He laid Harry gently on the doorstep, took a letter out of his cloak, tucked it inside Harry's blanket, and then came back to the other two. For a full minute, the three of them stood and looked at the little bundle. Hagrid's shoulders shook. Professor McGonagall blinked furiously in a twinkling light that usually shone Well, said Domino finally, that's that. We've no business staying here. We may as well go and join the celebrations.